Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Shepherds in the field abiding, watching o'er your flocks by night. God with us is now residing, yonder shines the infant light. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
Good morning, guys. Stand to your feet. We're going to have some fun this morning and open up with singing some Christmas carols. And so we want to invite you to join us out and have some fun while doing it. Here we go.
Thank you.
exaltation. Sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, all glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord.
Can you sing this last one out with us? Good job, guys. Thank you for your great singing, and you can have a seat.
Hey, good morning. Welcome to Christ Community Church. My name's Glenn. I work with our college ministry here. I'm joining you live from our atrium, our main lobby here at CCC. And if you're new with us this morning, thanks for spending your Sunday morning here with us. I want to go ahead and invite the ushers in both of our venues to come forward to receive this morning's offering. And if you're new with us, I want to let you know there's no pressure or obligation for you to give. We're really just glad that you're here. If you would call Christ Community Church home, I want to give you three ways you can contribute to what's happening in the life of our church. The first is via the baskets that are being passed around. The second is online anytime throughout the week. And the third is by texting a dollar amount to the number on your screen. And I'm joining you in the worship center, in Access, and online, and I have the privilege, while offering is being taken, to tell you about some cool things happening at our church. The first being our Family to Family initiative. We are partnered with Bridge Church in North Omaha, and we're putting together these boxes to help feed hungry kids from Franklin Elementary School during the holiday season. And church, you have already outdone yourselves, which is typical. Glowing generosity. We have 1,000 boxes and counting heading toward Christmas Day. So that's something to celebrate. Now, if you walk with me over this way, if you're new with us, I want to give you some basic steps that you can take to get plugged in here. The first one is called Starting Point. And there's some amazing people here who would love to get to know you, would love to connect with you, give you some basic info about our church, give you a free gift, and then also offer you an optional tour of our facility so you know where things are located. Right next to that is Group Link. And we have what we call journey groups that meet across the city. Some of them meet here at Christ Community on site. perfect way for you to get involved in a smaller community of people, get better and deeper plugged into a community here. So come to GroupLink, figure out if there's one that's close to you that works with your schedule. So the last thing down here is called Foundations. It's kind of distant, but Foundations is a 3-week course that we offer here, and it's perfect for anyone who is interested in learning a little bit more of what it is to be a disciple of Christ. And also, if you're interested in making CCC your official church home by becoming a member, Foundations is your best bet. So you can come out here, sign up for our next Foundations course. Now, we got some hustle and bustle out here, but if you make your way across, got something cool we want to announce to you guys. We have this new church-wide series that we're doing. It's called Simply Jesus, and we're going to start January 3rd. And it's a look at the Gospel of John. And so on this side of our atrium, you can see, you can sign up for a Simply Jesus group. You can sign up to host a Simply Jesus group. And we're always looking for people who are willing to open their homes and make community. The third thing, certainly not the least, is our resource center. We've actually partnered with Parables Bookstore down the road. You can get an exclusive 30% discount on one of our special study Bibles here for Simply Jesus if you get it at our resource center. We also have journals, study guides. So everything you need, Simply Jesus on this side of the church. Follow me over here. You'll notice there's someone playing piano. We got a Christmas tree. It is beginning to look a lot like Christmas around here at CCC. And we're really excited for that because people seem to be open to Jesus during this season. And so we want to invite you to invite some of your friends, coworkers, family, neighbors, whoever it might be, to come and join us for our Christmas Eve services. And we have these invitation kits. They have Christmas cards, candy cane invites. These are available for you as you leave the service. So perfect right there waiting for you. I want to let you know about our Christmas Eve services. We have two, on December 23rd at 5 and 7 p.m. We also have three on December 24th, Christmas Eve, at 3, 5, and 7 p.m. And I want to warn you that we are typically packed out at the 5 and 7 p.m. services on December 24th. So you may be wise to consider going to one of the other three. But with that said, I want to invite you to stand up wherever you are in whatever venue. Go ahead and greet the people around you. Let them know you're glad that they're here today. Thanks.
Praise you for that. We celebrate that this morning, and we put it at the center of all things. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can have a seat. You know, here we are in week three of our series leading up to Christmas called Good News of Great Joy. And for the last 2 weeks and continuing today, we're just exploring what we often say is the reason for the season, and that's Jesus and his birth and the hope that that offers for the world. But the reality is that it doesn't always feel that way. And it's not always easy to acknowledge that we have a good news of great joy in Jesus. You know, if we look around in our city, in our world, and even in our own hearts, it's tempting to ask, is peace real? Is peace possible? And I know for me, on a smaller scale than many, even in this month of December, it gets busier, more pressure, and it's easy to relate those feelings at Christmas time instead of what I know in my heart to be true and good news. And I know many of you, if not all sitting in the seats, come from a similar place, much less maybe, much worse even, death, tragedy, pain, and feelings of hopelessness here during this Christmas time. But the good news is that we can cling to what we know to be true in our minds, in our hearts, and deep down in our souls, that Jesus is real and that he brings hope and love and good news to the world. And as God worshipers, we can cling to that truth even when it doesn't feel like that's true. You know, we're not alone either. In fact, about 150 years ago, a poet by the name of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow wrote a Christmas hymn. It was in 1861. And he wrote it in the wake of a series of tragic events that had happened in his own life, beginning with the death of his wife. Accidentally, her dress caught on fire, and she died tragically. Her name was Fanny. And that same year, the Civil War began, and he learned that his son had enlisted to fight in the Union Army. And 2 years later of fighting, in the month of December in 1863, he learned that his son had suffered a severe injury, escaping death just by a small bit. And it was in that time, in the month of December of 1863, that he wrote this hymn that you're going to hear in just a moment. And you'll hear similar themes of pain and loss, and tragedy, held up in tension against the hope and peace that we know we have in Jesus, even when it doesn't feel like it. Our trust in a God that we know will prevail.
There.
right. Good morning, church. Good to see all of you here today. My name is Mark. I serve as the lead pastor here at Christ Community. And we have some good news for you this morning. Christ is born. This is good news. Amen. And because we have good news, let's stand up. We're going to say our good news creed together. All of our different venues, let's stand up here together. And we're going to be able to say out loud with the degree of enthusiasm that you believe in the good news. We're going to say this good news creed together. So church, what is the good news? The good news is that God the Father spoke the universe into existence. He loves people and wants to redeem them. That God the Son became a human being named Jesus, our Savior, Sanctifier, Healer, and Coming King. He lived to bring God's kingdom to earth. He died on the cross for the forgiveness of sins. He rose from the dead to bring us new life. That God the Holy Spirit lives in the believer to empower, comfort, and guide. And to be the very presence of Jesus with us. We believe that Jesus is present in the church, his body, that the power of God can transform a human life, that God assures believers of forgiveness, hope, and eternal life, and that the return of Jesus is sure. This is the good news. Amen? Amen. Let's praise God for that. You can be seated. Well, it is great for me to have the opportunity to be back with you here today. Many of you know that the last couple of weeks, my family and I and 46 of what are now our closest friends all went to Israel together. And we had a fun adventure over there, experiencing all kinds of things. I mean, there's just nothing like taking a boat ride on the Sea of Galilee and saying, look, that's where Jesus walked. You know, it's amazing to be able to walk down the side of the mountain where Jesus came down on the triumphal entry into Jerusalem and say, this is what it looked like for Jesus. This is where the palm branches were thrown. And probably for me, the most amazing thing was the fulfillment of a lifelong dream to actually go to the empty tomb of Jesus, that garden tomb, and peek inside. And I got good news for you, friends. He's not in there. He is not in there at all. He's risen from the dead, and we can worship a risen Lord. That's good news. Amen? So I'm not going to give you like a report. This is what I did on my winter vacation kind of report for you of, you know, all the sites that we went to. But my guess is that this is just going to leak out into my teaching over the next few months for sure. I hope that you'll benefit as much or at least somewhat as I have from going there. I just hope that you don't get sick of me saying the phrase, when I was in Israel. So we're going to continue on in our series, Good News of Great Joy, that we've been going through. And just for point of review, a couple of weeks ago, Sky Jatani was here, and he taught us that the idea of the good news, the word gospel means good news. And it's not just any old kind of good news. It's good news specifically in the historical context, good news of a king being born. A new king coming into his birth, and everybody celebrates that that king himself is born. And people rejoice because of that, but of course the idea that the gospel would be preached for somebody whose dad isn't a king, somebody like Jesus, would be a politically subversive thing to begin to declare. And the good news that Jesus is Lord would be equally politically subversive to declare. Because the good news is that Caesar is not Lord, the president is not Lord, consumerism is not Lord, pluralism is not Lord, Jesus is Lord. This is the good news that we experience in the gospel. The world is not wrapped around those other things. The world is wrapped around him. And then we continued on with learning last week about how the good news of Jesus is all about the hope of the world. hope for a past that's been secured by what Jesus has already done, and hope for our future, both in this world and for all eternity. We're given hope because of the gospel of Jesus. And this week, we are going to accelerate from, first of all, talking about the good news to hope. This week is peace. Next week is going to be joy. And we'll be unpacking that idea of peace this week. And who doesn't need peace? You know, who wouldn't say that they would love their life to be characterized by peace? Because the truth is, we live in a world that's a mess. You know, we just have our normal problems that people every day experience. How do we get food on the table? How do we find a place to be able to live and afford to live there? And this is accelerated by a fast-paced, microwavable world that we live in, where we have increased expectations at work, media saturation, an expectation of constant entertainment, shallow relationships, and many people in that environment find it difficult to relax, to even find a moment of peace. And especially in the chaos of Christmas time, with gifts and parties and shopping and, oh my, extended family. It's hard to find peace during that time. And it's funny that this season that was originally framed up as peace on earth has really become crazy on earth. And I want to take you back to a key scripture that will lead us back to that idea of peace on earth. So turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 8. And we'll be unpacking the story of the shepherds. But before we get there, a little bit of context of what's happening here. A couple by the name of Mary and Joseph have become pregnant, not Mary and Joseph, but Mary has become divinely pregnant with the Son of God. And because of a census, they're moving from their hometown of Nazareth to Bethlehem. And this is kind of the typical picture of what you see when you imagine Mary and Joseph heading off to Bethlehem. You got Mary and Joseph, who they're probably a little bit too old in this picture. They're actually teenagers when this all would have taken place. And they're traveling together. Joseph is walking. Mary is on a donkey, yeah. Which, interestingly, you probably know donkey is never in the biblical narrative about Mary. It's just something that's in every picture that's painted about Mary. And there might have been a donkey, but we just don't know. And the truth is that Joseph probably came in a big group with all of his family. We always see them pictured as being just the two of them. But if Joseph had to go, because that's where his family lineage was, then that's where his dad would have had to go, and his brothers and his uncles and cousins and anybody who is of the same lineage of him, they probably would have gone in a large group to go down to Bethlehem. And when they got to Bethlehem, they found out that their extended family who lived in Bethlehem had no room in their guest rooms for them to be able to stay. So they set up shop just wherever they could. This teenage dad and a teenage mom who are still just engaged, knowing that they're very close to the time when they are going to be having a baby. And our story picks up in that same city in Bethlehem in Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 8. It says this: "And there are shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night." Now let's take a pause right there. Let's go into the shepherd's world just a little bit. So when I was in Israel, I was surprised about how close Jerusalem was to Bethlehem. I mean, you can look at it on a map. It's only about 6 miles distance there, but it's really, really close. And when you think about how close Jerusalem is to Bethlehem in Omaha terms, you might think of a distance of Papillion. Like, that's just about how far it is from Jerusalem to Bethlehem. Or if you think in terms of population, there are only a couple hundred people in Bethlehem, so it'd be like, Omaha to Wahoo. Just this little town that's not very far outside of Jerusalem. And because it was so close to Jerusalem, the shepherds probably were raising sheep that their cash value would be in terms of sacrifices at the temple that was just 6 miles away. Because when all of the crowd swelled coming into Jerusalem for the festivals and for their sacrifices, people oftentimes couldn't bring their sheep along with them that very long journey. It was easier just to buy one when they got there. So these sheep were being raised in the fields with the thought in mind that they would become eventually a sacrifice. And during the Passover time, a sacrifice to be able to pay for the sins of the people. And notice that these shepherds would have that idea of sacrifice of their sheep, of their lambs, in mind the entire time that they're raising those sheep. And notice the symbolism of Jesus, the Lamb of God, being born in the same place with the same intention in mind. So picture these guys who are shepherds. Now, shepherd was not a high-status job. These guys did not graduate first in their class. They're not the top candidates to marry your daughter. It was a dirty job in the middle of the fields, night after night, without bathing. No status. They walked the rocky hillsides, caring for vulnerable, bleeding, and yes, even stupid animals. Occasionally, they would have a pregnant mom, a ewe, that was ready to give birth. If possible, they would bring her into a sheltered environment for her to be able to give birth to the lamb. Now, you need to know that dotting the hillsides all around Bethlehem are not only these rocky hills, but carved out of the rocky hills are these grottos. And let me show you one of these grottos, because I was in Israel last week. So this is what it would look like. This is one that they let tourists go into. It's actually been converted into a kind of a chapel, but it gives you the idea of the size and the dimensions. The roof is high, I don't know, maybe 10 feet high in there as we walked around, easy to walk around in. It would have been carved out of the hillside through wind and water. And it was the kind of place that would be warm for the sheep in the winter, but cool in the summer. So it was a perfect place to be able to keep them at night. It was probably, 12 feet deep and maybe 30 feet long. So quite a bit could fit in there. And you'll notice these little shelf-like things that you have in the backdrop that were just naturally there that they could put their implements there or whatever they wanted. Inside of these, when they would keep the animals there, they would also keep the food for the animals there. And they would set it out in these troughs. And the feeding troughs is where the sheep would eat from. And the feeding troughs, of course, were called mangers. But if you were to be looking for a manger, find out where's the most likely place for it to happen. I don't want you to think of a barn in the backyard of an inn like I have in the nativity set that's sitting on the top of my television. Instead, I want you to think of a cave, a grotto that would have had a little trough, a feeding trough, a manger that they would find in there. And this is where the shepherds would go in order to be able to find their shelter. So here we are outside Bethlehem on a rocky hillside in Judea, and this happens to the shepherds. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone all around them, and they were terrified. The angel said to them, "Don't be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy." That's where we get the title of our series from, this line right here. Good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Now, I want you to note something here, that when God shows up, rarely is there peace. Rarely is there peace. Normally, there is terror. And that's what happened with these guys. Imagine yourself being out on that hillside. You know, you're just watching a bunch of stupid sheep trying to stay awake on the midnight shift when all of the sudden, boom shakalaka, the glory of God shines all around you. And you go, what is going on here? An angel starts speaking to you, and it says what their emotional state was. They were terrified. They weren't bored. They weren't intrigued. They were not rejoicing. They were shaken in their boots, and a small trickle went down their right leg. And then the angel of the Lord shows up with that line. You know, it's the angel line. It's the first line that every angel learns when they go to angel school. Do not be afraid. When the angel shows up to Zechariah and tells him that his ancient wife is going to have a baby, he says, do not be afraid. Not sure if that was about the angel or the pregnancy. And then when he shows up to Mary, he says, do not be afraid. You have found great favor with God. Shows up to the shepherds, do not be afraid. I bring you great joy. As an interesting aside, do you know how many times the phrase do not be afraid or fear not or something similar to that shows up in the Bible? 365 times. And I think that's intentional. Because every day we have new fears that come into our lives. Every day we need to have that line said to us, do not be afraid. So my question for you today is, this is one of those 365 days, what's driving your fear today? What's driving your fear today? You look out in the headlines and you see a world that's out of control. ISIS is gaining in power. We see poor governmental decisions that are being made. Terror attacks in California or crime in North Omaha are on the increase. A clear drift in morality is happening in the United States, and people are drifting further from God. And this leaves many with a generalized fear about the direction of our country. And perhaps that describes you. Or maybe for you, it's anxiety that's driven by finances that are tight or the recent loss of a job. Or perhaps you have a kid who's off the hook and running in a destructive direction in their life, and that's driving fear inside of you. Maybe stress at work is so high that you find yourself a victim of panic attacks, like someone sitting on your chest and you just can't breathe. Or you wake up early in the morning and the adrenaline is already shooting through your body. This oftentimes happens to people who are like high performers, people who their whole life they've been able to get everything done, but they hit a certain point where they hit the wall and the stress comes off the hook. Maybe it's stress from a traumatic episode like having been through a war or a personal trauma that's been in your life. Maybe you're experiencing extra stress because you have the favor of God in your life. Have you ever noticed that people who have the favor of God are never bored? They're never bored. Mary saw the angel, and the angel said, don't be afraid, you have found favor with God. What does that mean for her? That she's going to be a pregnant teenage mom in a culture that frowned upon pregnant teenage moms. This was an addition of stress that was going on in her life. When you find people who are underneath the favor of God, they experience life as an adventure. Do you want a sleepy, boring, humdrum life? Then don't seek the favor of God. Because when God brings about his favor, he takes you on an adventure. Because he knows that it's in life's highs and lows, it's the roller coaster of life, that he's able to do his deepest work inside of you. And when you have the favor of God on your life, God is doing amazing, deep work. So sometimes that anxiety is caused because things are going so difficult, but sometimes it's because things are going under the favor of God. And all of us need to be told those words, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. You know, anxiety disorders are the most common mental illness in the United States, affecting over 40 million people, 18% of our population. If that's true, then this morning at Christ Community Church and all of our different venues together, 570 people have diagnosable anxiety disorders. One of the things you need to know is if that's you, we're here for you. We know those things strike in the Christmas season especially. And even tonight, we've got a seminar that's designed specifically for you. Dr. Wendell Nelson, Dr. James Connolly, two of our staff pastors and counselors, have put together this free seminar that's going to be tonight at 6 o'clock in room 117. Tonight at 6 o'clock in room 117. And they'll be able to take you through exercises and some key thoughts and stories that will help you to deal with the anxiety that could be riddling your life. And so it's called Peace is Greater Than Anxiety. And they'll not only take you through that, but they'll introduce you to some counselors and group life and other things that will help you to deal with the anxiety. So bring a family member tonight at 6 o'clock and see what you can learn if that's you. But for all of us, let's take a look back at the shepherds. Because the angels had a message for them. It started off, do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. So he says, today in the town of David, Bethlehem, that's right down the hillside, right next door there, a Savior has been born. Now, the town of David, of course, is Bethlehem. And Bethlehem was famous already by that time. It was famous for being the place where King David had been born and where King David had been raised. And everybody in town would know this. Every farmer, every midwife, every shepherd would be familiar with this idea that our city is famous because we got the most famous and powerful king in all Israel was born in our city, who was born in your city. They'd have bragging rights about this, right? So they would know that not only was David born there, but there was a prophecy in 2 Samuel chapter 7 that another David was going to come along, and that that David would sit on the throne of the original David forever and ever. And they looked forward to this second David coming. They were Jewish shepherds, so they knew a lot of the prophecies that said, there is a Messiah who's coming, who's going to save the world. And now, all of a sudden, they're on a hillside, and the angel, the messenger, says to them, this thing that you've been waiting for 1,000 years, is happening tonight. Right here in the city of David. He is the Messiah. He is the Lord. Messiah means the anointed one. And David had been anointed in that very city by Samuel to be king. And they say, now there is another anointed one who's here to be with you. 1,000 years are up. Good news. Well, suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to men on whom his favor rests. And there it is again, a desire of peace for those on whom God's favor rests. So one messenger multiplies into a great company. It's party time on the hillside. And this matches what oftentimes would have happened when there was a gospel of good news of another king being born. So what the original king, when his new son that's going to take over the throne is born, what he would do is he'd send a choir out into the streets of his capital city, and they would sing praises to the newborn king. And God says, that's a cool idea, but I can one-up that one. And he sends a celestial choir to be up in the sky and for them to be able to proclaim glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace on whom his favor rests. Peace. Peace. Peace on earth. That's something that all of us yearn for, isn't it? When people go out and do that man on the street interview and say, if you could have one wish, what would it be? The phrase that oftentimes comes up more common than any other one is, I wish for peace on earth. Peace on earth. Because we live on a planet that's riddled by war. Moody Bible Institute reported this incredible statistic. Since the beginning of recorded history, the entire world has been at peace less than 8% of the time. In its study, the periodical discovered that of 3,530 years of recorded history, only 286 years saw peace. And that's only with wars that we know about from recorded history. Moreover, in excess of 8,000 peace treaties have been made and broken during that time. Currently in the world, there are over 18 wars with over 1,000 deaths in each war in the past year. Now, I'm not sure that we can ever have hope that this world, as long as it's in its sin-scarred condition, will ever be without war. We have external conflict in this world. We always have, and as long as we're in this world, we will have tribulation. That's what Jesus said. But external conflict can drive us towards needing our need for internal peace. And while we can't always hope that everything in the world will be okay and there will never be war, there can be a hope for an internal sense of peace. Because peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is the presence of God. It's not the absence of conflict. It is the presence of God. I think God did design human beings to be able to experience peace in the deepest and most powerful ways. No matter how strong the conflict is that rages all around us, it's an internal peace that's given to us by the Prince of Peace. You know, the good news of the kingdom is that when God came into your zone, into your environment, he did not come to make war with you. He came to make peace with you. Unlike Caesar, who marched into Israel to conquer, Jesus came into Israel and Omaha in order to establish his kingdom of love and make peace with you. If he wanted war, he could have had it. He would have just opened up his divine can of judgment and you would lose. But his love is so expansive that he came to bring peace with you through the mechanism of his blood shed on a cross. That little lamb that was born in Bethlehem, where lambs were born for sacrifice, grew up in order to become a sacrifice for you and for me. Jesus knew that there was a cosmic war between people and God, that people ran from God, people made war against God by their souls and the way that they lived. And he said, I've come to this world in order to bring reconciliation between people and God, so that men and women can now know God. And he gave his life as a sacrifice in order to reconcile us back to God. He is the lamb that was born in Bethlehem to be sacrificed to make you right with God. He is the son of David, born in Bethlehem, designed to sit on David's throne forever and reign over a kingdom of peace that constantly brings people to God through good news. And when the disciples got this, as Jesus grew up and trained his disciples, and then they went out and shared this news with the whole world, they understood that peace with God was made possible through Jesus' blood shed on the cross. Acts 10:36 says this. This is the message of the good news for the people of Israel. The message is that there is peace with God through Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of all. The essence of the good news summarized right here: peace with God through Jesus Christ, who is the Lord of all. Somebody say, that is good news. That is good news. And then Paul said it a different way in the book of Colossians. He says, for God was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in him, and that him is Jesus, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. So here we have the incarnation of Christmas time, all of God's fullness dwelling in the person of Jesus, and we have peace with God that was made at the end of Jesus' life through his blood that was shed on the cross for you and for me. And we have God's plan in between here, that human beings would be reconciled to God. But it's more than that, because it's not just individuals that would be reconciled to God. God's about reconciling all things to himself, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace. You see, God's cosmic plans are bigger than just reconciling humanity to himself. God is about recreating a world that would completely align with him, that everything would one day be reconciled to God. And eventually, that is what God's plan is, made possible through Jesus' death on the cross. And this is stage one of experiencing peace. There's three stages I want to talk about today, but stage one is you can have individual peace with God by trusting Jesus and his death on the cross in order to make peace between you and God. But stage two is this: you can experience peace in your life every day, even as a storm rages all around you. You do not need to live with anxiety. You do not need to live without hope. You can beat chaos by centering yourself on God. What do I mean by that? Especially if you're someone who's here today, you say, I got some anxiety in my life and I need some tools to begin to deal with that. Well, here's what I'd recommend you do. Go and find some alone time, find some space that can be carved out for you to spend some time asking God three key questions in your life. As you reflect on your life and the chaos that's around it, ask these three questions. Number one, where are you, God? Where are you, God? I mean, the truth is, God's never left. He said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. But oftentimes we live experientially without recognizing the presence of God in the middle of our chaos. And asking God, where are you, God, helps you to envision him in the middle of the storm with you. So ask, where are you, God, and then envision him in that place. Number two, ask yourself the question, what are you doing? What are you doing, God? Because God is up to something. He's up to something. God is never the one who creates the chaos in your life, but he enters with you into the chaos in order to redeem it and do amazing things deep in your soul. He's always got something that he's up to. Now, it is true that sometimes God comes into your life and he stills the storms that are all around your life. Those of you who have walked with God for a long time can look back over the years and say, that year we had this storm, this year we had that storm, this year we had that storm. And you can see that in time, God stills the storms that are the ups and downs of your life. But the truth of the matter is, God doesn't always still those storms, does he? Sometimes he lets those storms rage in us and around us for a while in order to be able to do a deep work inside of us. Sometimes he stills the storm. Sometimes he's about stilling your soul and enabling you to learn to live with peace even when storms rage all around you. And you have to ask yourself the question, what are you doing, God? And whatever you find out God's doing, then join him in that. Join him in what he's doing in your life. And then the third thing is to ask yourself a question, or better, ask God the question, what am I missing? What am I missing? Because God's plans and purposes are huge. They're always bigger than what you could imagine. They're always bigger than your little experience of life. So ask him, God, what am I missing? What are your bigger purposes that are being accomplished here? What can I not see here? And then when you begin to see the unseen, when you begin to gain a broader picture, imagine it. And you'll experience some deeper levels of peace as you walk with God. Because these three facts, that God is there, God is up to something, and God has plans that are way bigger than what you are experiencing, knowing these three facts gives you the ability to have peace in the midst of the storm. So go to a quiet place and ask God those questions to experience that deep inner peace. But there's even a third stage. There is a third level, and that third level is the level of shalom. Shalom. So when I was in Israel, people would always greet each other with the word shalom. Everybody say shalom. Shalom. And shalom is hello, and shalom is goodbye, and shalom is a greeting of peace towards one another. And shalom does mean peace, but it means something even deeper than that. Shalom means a wholeness and a completeness and a oneness with God where everything is made right. It's a divine rightness. And the Jewish people were waiting for a new era of shalom to be ushered in. The prophet Isaiah even predicted that this would happen. He called the person who would usher in this era the Prince of Peace, or the Prince of Shalom. And this shalom is a time when righteousness and truth will prevail, a time when chaos gives way to order and despair gives way to hope. But when all is right in the world and all is right in your soul, you can live in perfect peace. And what I mean by this concept of shalom is that when you get yourself so wrapped around God in your everyday life that everything that you are doing aligns with God in his perfection and in his shalom, you'll find that the vacillations of the external world have very little impact on the peace of your soul. And that you can live in a kind of a perfect peace with God no matter what's happening around you. So that the peace of God just drips off of you regardless of what your circumstances are. That God's peace infects the people who are around you and the situations that you're in. So three stages. You have peace with God through Jesus and his death shed on the cross. Number two, you can experience peace in your life, in your circumstances right now. And stage three is you can have an all-pervasive sense of shalom in your life by connecting with God and ordering everything around his lordship. Three stages of peace. But back to our shepherds for a minute. There's a funny thing about those shepherds. They never actually go seeking peace. They seek Jesus and get peace thrown in as a bonus. Shepherds seek Jesus and get peace thrown in as a bonus. That is the right order. Seek Jesus and get peace thrown in as a bonus. Check out how the shepherds respond. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, hey, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. Where do you find mangers? Find them in grottos. And in this small town of Bethlehem, they would have known every shepherd, every grotto, every manger that there was. It would not have taken them very long to find the one manger where the baby Jesus had been laid. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. You know what I love about these guys? I love that they are action-oriented guys. That as soon as they hear about this, they say, hey, common sense thing, let's go to Bethlehem and check this out. Let's meet the Messiah. Let's find out about this thing that could not only change our lives, but change all of world history. They do the common sense thing. And I wonder if at this point, as they're walking to Bethlehem, they go, guys, I cannot believe that God picked us to show up to. Like, of all the high status people in the world, he picked a bunch of stinky shepherds on the midnight shift on the side of a hillside. And we get to do this. We get to go and see the Messiah. This is so cool. I wonder if you've ever had that thought about yourself as well. Like, I wonder why God picked me. I wonder why he chose me to be the one who is inside his family. I wonder why I get to be the one who experiences Jesus. Because the shepherds, they not only experienced Jesus, then as soon as they saw him, they went out and told everybody about Jesus. They got to be God's messengers, hand-selected from off of a hillside. And guess what? You get to be God's messengers too. You've seen Jesus, you've experienced Jesus. You get to be the one to tell people that the one who saves us is here. And life can be different. And you can experience hope and peace and joy through this Jesus. And this is not true of everybody. I think the shepherds stand in a direct contrast to some other people who got the good news. So just up the road, about 6 miles in Jerusalem, you've got Herod, who is one of those high status guys that you would expect God to talk to. You've got his scholars that are all around his court that you would expect the message to be able to come to. And what do you know? The message did come to them. Magi from the east come trucking across the desert, and they say, hey, we've seen this star and heard that a king is born right here in your midst. Can you tell us where he is? And Herod says, I don't know. Let me get the scholars in here. The scholars come in. He says, guys, where is that baby supposed to be born again? And they said, in Bethlehem. Just a hop, skip, and a jump away. So he tells them, in Bethlehem. And when you find that little baby, tell me about him so that I may go and worship him. But Herod himself doesn't go. Even though it's a quick little walk, he can go there himself and figure it out. The scholars, they don't go. They stay there in the court in Jerusalem, even though it's not very far, and they've been waiting for this for thousands of years. They don't even take the walk to see if the baby is there. They sit back. And maybe that's why God picks the ordinary people. Because the scholars and the king, they can't be bothered with this stuff. The shepherds say, this could change our lives. So let's go and seek Jesus and let's tell everyone about him. The question you have to handle with yourself today is, who are you going to be? You going to be a scholar? Or are you going to be a shepherd? Seek Jesus and let everyone know about his perfect peace. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together for closing prayer. God, we're so grateful for your peace that's come into this world. We're glad that when you came as a king, you came as a king to bring peace between human beings and God. And we're thankful that even though we were the ones who were in rebellion, that you paid the price so that we could have that peace. God, if there's anyone here today who has never experienced that change in their status of relationship with you, I just pray that right now they would say to you, God, I believe in you. I believe in your son. I believe in his birth and his death and his resurrection. And that as they say that, they know they'll be welcomed into this new family, this family that gives perfect peace. And we pray, God, as we go through the busyness and the nuts of the holidays, we pray, God, that we would experience your peace and your joy and your hope during this time, that we'd be reminded of Jesus and that we'd be like the shepherds and not like the scholars. May that be true of our lives as we seek after you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. God's people said, amen. 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 God bless you all.